Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Technology's Child, Digital Media's Role in the Ages and Stages of Growing Up, by Katie Davis, narrated by Wendy Tremont King. Preface. Research on kids and technology can be complicated, confusing, and inconclusive. Headlines and talking heads are even worse. This book brings clarity to the current state of knowledge related to technology's role in child development, and provides guidance on how to apply the insights to individual children and adolescents, so that their digital experiences will support rather than undermine healthy development. The book examines the variety of ways that young people engage with technology across the course of their development, from toddlers who are exploring their immediate environment to 20-somethings who are exploring their role in society. At its core, Technology's Child is about what happens when child development interacts with technology design, and how this interaction is complicated by children's individual characteristics and their social and cultural contexts. My research indicates that technology supports healthy child development when it's self-directed and community-supported. It impedes development when it's not. By self-directed, I mean technology experiences that are initiated, sustained, and ended voluntarily, and that support a feeling of personal accomplishment and growth. By community-supported, I mean technology experiences that are embedded in broader contexts of support. Sometimes, the support is surrounding the technology use, like when a parent or sibling helps a child navigate the interface of a literacy app and reinforces the learning concepts during and after the app session. Sometimes the support comes from within the technology experience itself, like when a teen finds a supportive online community whose members affirm the teen's marginalized identity, or when a social media platform works out a thoughtful, effective approach to moderating hate speech. Creating the best-case scenario isn't easy. It requires attention and work on the part of families and teachers, researchers, policymakers, and tech companies, and even young people themselves. The insights from this book will provide actionable guidance for each of these stakeholders. So, what counts as technology for the purposes of this exploration? I focus my analysis on technologies that have one or more of the following qualities. Digital, the zeros and ones that undergird the pixels on your computer screen. Interactive, the response you get when you make a swiping motion on your phone. And networked, the ability to consume and share content and connect with others across devices. Many of the technologies I examine have screens, phones, tablets, laptops, but not all, smart speakers, smart toys, and other devices powered by Internet of Things, IoT technologies. For the most part, I focus on existing technologies that are already ubiquitous in the lives of most children in developed countries. But I'll also consider some emerging technologies too. Who this book is for? This book is for anyone who is interested in and concerned about the impact of technology on children's development, from birth through emerging adulthood. I cover a lot of research terrain in these chapters, which I've attempted to distill into a set of readily accessible and actionable ideas for a parent who is trying to keep up with the technologies their children use daily, curious, and perhaps a bit, or very, concerned about how these technologies are impacting their children's development, and who is seeking practical guidance on how to make good decisions when it comes to their children's technology use. A teacher who wants to understand the broader context of their students' digitally mediated lives outside the classroom, and use technology to support meaningful, rich learning experiences inside the classroom. A policymaker, whether at the local, state, or federal level, who is seeking evidence-based insights to guide policy decisions aimed at mitigating the negative effects of technology while retaining its positive influences in children's lives. A design team, project manager, or executive at a tech company who recognizes the importance of drawing on research knowledge to inform their decisions about how technologies are developed, disseminated, and marketed to children of different ages and their families. A researcher or student who would like to inform their own thinking about and understanding of technology's role in child development. As evidenced by this list, the solution to supporting children's positive technology experiences is not an individual one. It cannot and should not fall on individual parents, teachers, or tech developers. We must start looking at the broad conditions of children's technology use if we want to create an ecosystem of digital experiences that align with their developmental needs. Ultimately, this book should give listeners a way to think through and make sense of what's going on developmentally when a child interacts with a digital device, and what conditions are likely to make their experiences more self-directed and community-supported. In other words, more supportive of healthy development. One thing is clear from the disparate research studies addressing kids and technology: it's time to get specific. We need to consider specific technologies, specific children, and the specific contexts connecting the two if we want to truly understand what's going on with technology's role in child development. Why I wrote this book. Technology's child is shaped by my knowledge and expertise as a researcher. I've studied children's and teens' technology use for more than 15 years. It's also shaped by my experiences as a parent, chapters 2 through 4, a former elementary school teacher, chapter 5, and a sister, chapter 7. I use these personal experiences in the chapters following here to help bring aspects of the research I'll explore to life. I don't intend my experiences to represent some sort of norm in children's technology. I intend the opposite. I use these personal experiences to call attention to the individual, personal dimensions of research on children and technology. Examining the when, why, and for whom of technology's impact on children requires paying attention to individual differences, instances when children and their circumstances don't conform to the average trend line. My stance as a researcher is every bit as individual and specific as my role as a parent, teacher, and sister. I was trained by two developmental psychologists, Howard Gardner and Kurt Fisher, in an education school, Harvard Graduate School of Education. For the last 10 years, I've worked at the University of Washington Information School, surrounded by colleagues whose work represents a broad range of scholarly disciplines. But I'm perhaps most influenced by those working in technology design. As a result, in my own work and in this book, I bring together the fields of human development, education, and technology design. This particular scholarly mix accounts for the two distinct questions that I explore in these chapters. The first is an empirical question, something that a psychologist or other social scientist would ask. What is the impact of different kinds of technologies on different kinds of children, experiencing different social, cultural, and economic contexts? If I had written the book after my doctoral studies, I would have stopped there. In fact, that's exactly what I did with my first book, The App Generation, co-authored with Howard Gardner. But my work for the last decade has been just as focused on exploring the design of new technologies as it has been on studying the impact of existing ones. So the second question guiding this book is a more action-oriented question, something that a design researcher would be more likely to ask. How can technology be designed to support children's development? Chapter 1. Introduction. At no other point in human history have we been so preoccupied with how we raise our children, and so concerned. For the first several thousand years of our existence, the goal was pretty much survival. First, survive childbirth. Then, survive long enough to contribute to the survival of the human species. The concept of childhood is a fairly recent invention. We used to perceive children as not yet grown adults. Just take a look at some family portraits from the 17th century. The children are depicted as miniature adults, fully developed, and sometimes even with faces as lined as the parents seated next to them. It wasn't until the field of child development was formed, less than a century ago, that we started to appreciate that children of different ages and stages think and experience the world in qualitatively different ways from adults. This understanding overlapped with the shift in industrialized societies from human survival to human flourishing. Families who benefited from the medical breakthroughs, technological advances, and increased economic prospects of the 18th and 19th centuries started turning their attention to raising children who would not just survive, but thrive. We've been pursuing this holy grail ever since. There's a lot about Western society that makes raising a child today particularly nerve-wracking for just about any parent. Growing economic inequality in an increasingly winner-take-all society? Civic unrest fueled by political and ideological polarization? A collective reckoning with the continued effects of racism, colonialism, and other forms of discrimination that marginalized groups of people? The Herculean challenge of slowing down, let alone reversing, the effects of climate change and environmental degradation? Add to this mix the speed of technological development, which seems to be shortening the length of generations to the point where older siblings look down at their younger, tech-savvier siblings, shaking their heads as they bemoan, "Kids these days." Parents have been living with the unease of raising digitally networked children for at least a generation now. The unease may feel more familiar, more par for the course, during the many uncertainties associated with parenting. But that doesn't make it any easier. Research that's filtered through sensational headlines, which often contradicts the research published the week before, doesn't help. I believe the coronavirus pandemic, in combination with other concurrent events, has given rise to a new readiness to engage with the topic of kids and technology on a deeper level than the months and years prior to March 2020. Before the pandemic, the collective zeitgeist seemed focused on some variation of the following questions. Screens, are they good or bad for children's development? And screen time, how much is too much? This period of online school, work, playdates, happy hours, fitness classes, therapy sessions, music lessons, and much, much more, taught us all that asking whether screens and screen time are good or bad are not the right questions. Technology has become too central to our lives. For instance, the pandemic called attention to the fact that while we all may rely on technology, we don't all enjoy equal access to it. When school buildings closed and classes moved online, we learned about the stark differences between kids living in affluent homes, whose circumstances ensured they had access to high-speed internet, a dedicated computer, a quiet space to work, and a network of supportive people to help keep them on track, and kids living in low-income homes, who too often had none of these things. These marked differences in children's pandemic experiences exposed and amplified existing inequities in our educational system, forcing us to ask, which children benefit most from technology and why? In the last quarter of 2021, the leaking of internal Facebook documents by former Facebook employee Frances Haugen shone a light on the power of opaque algorithms to shape our experiences on social media platforms. Although this power had been well documented previously, the media coverage surrounding the Facebook files helped bring it more directly into public consciousness. The public became more aware of how algorithms, designed to attract and hold our attention to platforms like Facebook and Instagram, and Snapchat, Twitter, TikTok, and YouTube, among others, can contribute to the spread of misinformation, hate speech, and the undermining of teens' mental health, preparing us to grapple with the question, how does the design of a technology shape the way children use it and are affected by it? These developments show clearly that relying on technology is not the same thing as thriving with technology. We're ready now to go deeper into the when, why, and for whom of technology's impact on children. We're ready to explore the conditions that create technology experiences that are self-directed and community-supported, which I argue are the two qualities that distinguish developmentally supportive use of technology. What is development? And what is healthy development? As a developmental scientist, I place front and center the understanding that the way children think about, interact with, and make sense of themselves and the communities they participate in is qualitatively different at different stages of development. A 2-year-old's way of interacting with their environment is clearly distinct from a 12-year-old's, due in large part to differences in the complexity of the cognitive structures that process and interpret their experiences, and how those structures interact with the people and cultural tools in their environment. The process of developing from a 2-year-old to a 12-year-old to a 22-year-old is, at its heart, a process of changing the way one interacts with and participates in one's cultural communities. Children at different stages of development engage in different types of developmental tasks. Whereas toddlers are learning to regulate their emotions while interacting primarily with adult caregivers, teens are learning about who they are, largely in the context of their peer relationships. To be sure, self-regulation is very much a work in progress throughout childhood and adolescence, but it's particularly central in early childhood. The same is true for identity development. Toddlers are doing important developmental work when it comes to differentiating themselves from the other people in their environment. However, grappling with who you are and how you fit into the broader world around you becomes more of a dominant focus during adolescence and emerging adulthood. A developmental perspective also recognizes that there's considerable individual variation in the process of development, and as a result, there exist many paths to healthy development. The process of development is going well when children experience a sense of initiative and ownership over their actions, a feeling that they can succeed and grow, and a sense of belonging and connection with the people in their communities. This happens when children engage in experiences, including technology-based experiences, that are self-directed and community-supported. Technology's role in healthy development. Technology supports healthy development when it's self-directed and community-supported. It impedes development when it's not. Self-directed technology experiences are voluntary. Voluntarily started, sustained, and ended, giving young people a sense of initiative and ownership over their actions. Technology experiences that are externally controlled, by contrast, either through rewards or punishments, are less voluntary and therefore less likely to support healthy development. Unfortunately, technology designers are very good at building incentives into their products to keep children and adolescents and adults using them long beyond when they would otherwise have moved on to another activity. In many, but not all cases, self-directed technology experiences are open-ended and flexible, allowing people to shape their experiences in a variety of different ways. Freehand drawing is open-ended. Paint by numbers is not. It's easy to find examples of each in an app store. Complete open-endedness isn't always necessary or even desirable. Sometimes external supports are appropriate, such as for young children who need help navigating the user interface of an app, or children with physical or cognitive disabilities whose use of assistive technologies greatly expands their range of actions. What's more important is that the technology experience supports children's feelings of mastery and personal growth. Children and adolescents don't use technology in a vacuum. Their digital experiences are embedded in broader contexts of support, sometimes surrounding the technology, sometimes within it. Community support that surrounds technology use can come from family members, peers, teachers, and any other cultural community that children participate in, like a church group or after-school club. Friends might work together to design a video game in the kid-friendly programming language, Scratch. A trusted adult or sibling might help a teen process and navigate troubling or hurtful speech they experience online. These surrounding community supports make young people's technology experiences better. Community support can come directly from the technology itself. As I'll discuss in Chapter 7, online communities like Tumblr have provided support for many teens who feel marginalized in other contexts of their lives, whether due to their race, gender, and/or sexual orientation. Community support also relates to the way a platform is structured and governed. A platform's features, affordances, and moderation strategies can have a big influence on the kind of culture that evolves on it and whether that culture supports members' sense of belonging and connection to others. Three themes: creating the conditions for self-directed and community-supported technology experiences is most likely to happen when we recognize and foreground the following. 1. The value of seeking a balance between average trends and individual children. 2. the importance of attending to the broader context of children's technology experiences. And 3, the need to consider the interaction between technology design and child development. Whether I'm focusing on early or middle childhood, adolescence, or emerging adulthood, these 3 themes recur throughout the book. Theme 1, balancing average trends and individual children. Research involving large numbers of children is valuable because it gives us an overall impression of general trends in a population. It's also a useful way to identify systemic differences that lead to common disparities among subpopulations in a society. For all the criticism that the No Child Left Behind Act generated when it was signed into U.S. law in 2001, even some of the legislation's strongest critics acknowledged the benefit of breaking down standardized test scores by race and income level, because doing so called attention to persistent inequities in the U.S. public school system. But there's a limit to the value to be drawn from general trends. This is because the statistical models that form the basis of population-based research typically rely on averages. Let's consider a hypothetical example involving the relationship between social media use and body satisfaction in teen girls. If you wanted to use the amount of time teen girls spend on social media sites like Instagram to predict how positively or negatively they feel about their bodies, you could generate a bunch of points on a graph, each one representing an individual teen girl's time spent on Instagram, a value on the x-axis, and their score on a measure of body satisfaction, a value on the y-axis. Next, you'd draw a line that goes through the middle of these points, such that the distance between all of the points falling above the line and the line itself is just about equal to the distance between all of the points falling below the line and the line. You'd use that line, not the points that generated it, to draw conclusions about the relationship between Instagram use and teen girls' body image. If it were falling steeply to the right, you'd conclude there's a generally strong negative relationship between Instagram use and body satisfaction. Not good. If it were dipping gently upward, you'd conclude there's a generally weak positive relationship. Better. These lines would allow you to make an informed guess about a specific teen girl's body satisfaction based on the amount of time they spend on Instagram. The problem is, you'd probably be wrong. Maybe not as wrong as pulling a value out of thin air, but wrong nonetheless. Very few, if any, people ever land exactly on the trend line. It turns out, very few people are average. Averages are good at describing behavior on a group level, but considerably less so at describing the behavior of individual children. Thankfully, researchers who study the role of technology in the lives of children and adolescents are increasingly making use of methods that highlight rather than gloss over individual variation. In this book, I attempt to emphasize such research while treating population-based research with more skepticism. At the same time, I'll discuss research that draws on averages because it can provide a good starting point for understanding general trends within a group of children, and it's especially useful for identifying systemic disparities affecting particular subpopulations. But we should resist using this general understanding to draw conclusions about specific children. Theme 2. Technology and child development take place in context. A criticism that's sometimes leveled at developmental scientists is that they overemphasize what's going on inside the head of a particular child, usually from a white middle-class community in North America or Europe, without paying enough attention to the diverse social, cultural, economic, and historical contexts that children experience. However, as cultural psychologist Barbara Rogoff has observed, people develop as participants in cultural communities. Their development can be understood only in light of the cultural practices and circumstances of their communities. In other words, understanding child development requires understanding the communities and cultural practices that children participate in. Cultural communities shape our impression of what's considered dangerous and what's considered beautiful, what counts as intelligent or athletic or funny, and how intelligence, athleticism, and humor are expressed. I spent much of my time while writing this book in Berlin, where many preschool Kita teachers don't think twice about letting 3- and 4-year-olds use hammers, nails, and saws to work unsupervised with wood planks, something that would surely lead to a lawsuit in the Seattle neighborhood I had come from. Children participate in a lot of different spaces, settings, and communities, each containing different configurations of people, practices, roles, and expectations. Sometimes the cultural practices across these contexts align, and sometimes they don't. Understanding how they relate and how they connect to broader societal institutions and ideologies is crucial. Let's return to the example of teen girls, social media, and body image. To do better than an average trend line at predicting the relationship between Instagram use and body satisfaction for a particular teen girl, it would help to have some understanding of her experiences with her peers and family members. What kinds of beauty ideals are promoted by each group of people? And how do they draw on, reinforce, or perhaps push back against broader cultural ideologies related to beauty? How do these dynamics influence what she sees and how she interprets content on Instagram? Does this teen participate in other communities, such as a church group, sports team, or after-school club, that de-emphasize physical appearance and elevate other qualities, such as teamwork, spirituality, and community? How does this teen's racial identity, and the degree to which it's either marginalized or centered in the broader society, influence whether and how she compares herself to the images she sees on Instagram? Questions like these highlight the importance of considering young people's varied social contexts, how these contexts relate to each other and the technologies used in them, and how all of these contexts are influenced by broader social, political, economic, and historical forces. This book does not attempt to account for all possible contexts that affect children's development across the globe. In fact, with respect to geography, I focus primarily on the contexts in which I conduct my own research, North America and Europe. That leaves a lot of the world unaccounted for. Within this geographically and culturally narrow focus, I've incorporated research that addresses children with a wide range of intersecting experiences, such as those living in different socioeconomic circumstances, belonging to different racial and ethnic groups, expressing different gender and sexual identities, and possessing a range of abilities and disabilities. Theme 3. Design matters. Technology is not neutral. The autoplay feature on Netflix makes it that much easier for children to watch multiple episodes of a television show and that much harder for parents to avoid a confrontation when they seek to turn off the device. When a show ends, recommender algorithms on Netflix and YouTube, Disney Plus, and other video streaming platforms determine what a child encounters next. Algorithms also determine the videos that show up on a teen's For You feed on TikTok, and the pictures they see as they scroll through their Instagram feed. These algorithms are designed to draw and keep people's attention based on the information they've collected from their prior interactions with the platform. People design things like autoplay and social media algorithms. Their values, goals, assumptions, and worldviews are embedded in what they create. Designers, developers, product managers, and other employees of technology companies are disproportionately white, male, highly educated, liberal, or libertarian. When they conjure a typical user, that person is more likely to resemble them than not, increasing the chances that the resulting technology serves some people better than others. The companies that tech designers work for also have their own set of values, goals, assumptions, and worldviews. Most centrally, these companies are motivated by the bottom line, not a person's well-being. The bottom line does well when people are on the platform, and companies have figured out the kind of content that keeps people engaged. Emotionally arousing posts typically win out over measured accounts of fact. This is why Facebook's algorithm prioritizes content with angry emojis over likes. I propose three layers for thinking about technology's influence on child development. The first is the feature layer, consisting of the zeros and ones of digital experiences. These are specific features: autoplay, the like button, the disappearing photo on Snapchat, Instagram filters, Twitter's saliency detection algorithm, TikTok's For You feed algorithm, that allow people to do and see certain things and not others when they interact with a particular technology. An algorithm may seem cold and impartial, but many human decisions go into its creation and use. Next comes the practice layer, which addresses the relationship between people and the features they're interacting with. Here, we talk of the affordances, or possibilities for action, of a technology as people engage with it. Features such as the retweet button on Twitter and the reblog button on Tumblr give rise to certain actions, making it easy for people to circulate content widely. Spreadability, therefore, represents an affordance of platforms like Twitter and Tumblr. Other affordances that characterize social media platforms include interactivity, people can interact with each other's content and ideas; reactivity, people can also simply react to content by clicking a heart or a like or angry emoji button; persistence, the digital traces created by posts even after they've been deleted; searchability, the ease of locating information quickly; replicability, the ease with which content can be copied; and anonymity. Some platforms make it easier to create identities other than one's government-issued identification. This list is by no means exhaustive for social media platforms or for the wider array of technologies that children interact with. What's important to keep in mind at the practice layer is the interaction between features and people, and the kind of behaviors that emerge as a result. Certainly, the individual design decisions that go into a technology matter here, but so do the motivations, skills, and values of the people engaging with it. The final layer is the culture layer. Here we ask, what kind of culture emerges in the context of a technology's features and affordances, and the way it's governed? Spend an hour each on Instagram and Tumblr, and you'll no doubt experience distinct cultures. There are many subcultures within each platform, so your experiences will likely be different from mine. Both Instagram and Tumblr are social media platforms, but they're designed and governed in quite different ways, giving rise to different user interactions, topics of discussion, norms of behavior, and so on. Here are just a few examples. Unlike Instagram, Tumblr isn't profile-based or linked to a person's legal name, making it much easier to experience a degree of anonymity or pseudonymity, which in turn makes people feel they can communicate more openly and about sensitive topics. Tumblr places more emphasis on interaction than reaction through features such as reblogs and replies. In contrast, the heart button on Instagram lends itself to quick reactions as people scroll through their feeds, and it represents a source of stress for many teens who monitor closely the number of likes their posts receive. Instagram's primary mode is visual. People post, like, and comment on their own and each other's photos, which has helped give rise to a culture of self-presentation and promotion. Tumblr content, by contrast, comes in many different forms, including text, image, GIF, meme, and link, helping support a community based on shared interest. What goes on at the feature, practice, and culture layers of technology use combine to shape young people's digital experiences in distinct and important ways. I'll use these layers throughout the book to explore the different ways that technology interacts with and influences child development. The chapters in this book. Technology's Child traces the arc of development from early childhood to middle childhood and adolescence, and ends in emerging adulthood. At each stage, I highlight one or two developmental tasks that are particularly salient, such as executive function and emerging literacy skills in early childhood, and peer relationships and identity formation in adolescence. This approach helps me scope a sprawling and complex topic while shining a spotlight on the key factors at play when it comes to technology's impact on child development. Chapter 2 explores the constellation of skills that form a person's executive function ability, including the all-important skill of self-regulation, whose successful development in early childhood helps place children on a path to personal well-being, positive relationships, and academic success. We'll consider how carefully designed digital content can support executive function development, as well as the design abuses that too often undermine it. We'll also take a look at parents' technology use, and I'll introduce the concept of the good enough digital parent. Chapter 3 continues to focus on early childhood as we consider another key developmental task of this period, early literacy development. As we explore literacy apps, conversational agents, and video chat platforms, we'll identify the qualities of self-directed, community-supported digital experiences that can support early literacy skills, such as vocabulary development and letter recognition. In Chapter 4, we'll explore the world of child's play and the many forms it can take in analog and digital contexts. We'll consider the value of loose parts in children's play experiences, and identify the kinds of digital experiences that enable loose parts play, and those that make it difficult. We'll also take a look at the affordances of video games, such as interactivity, low cost of failure, and clear and immediate feedback, that interact in complicated ways with individual children and their surrounding contexts. Chapter 5 examines technology's current and potential role in learning during middle childhood. When designed carefully, learning technologies can encourage children to pursue their interests. They can address children's diverse ways of learning, and they can be meaningfully integrated into the cultural contexts and communities that children participate in. Unfortunately, as we'll see, several barriers prevent this potential from being realized for all children, including unequal access to learning technologies and the supports needed to use them, and inflexible institutional structures that make it difficult to introduce new technologies into school settings. With its focus on early adolescence, Chapter 6 marks a shift away from adult-selected and adult-directed technology experiences to those that are more youth-driven. We'll consider how these technology experiences directed by young people can complicate the evolving relationship between parents and their tween children. We'll also explore how the features and affordances of social media platforms, such as like counts and publicness, and smartphones, such as notifications and mobility, place pressure on tweens' changing peer relationships and sense of self, giving rise to digital stress and cyberbullying among some tween children. Chapter 7 examines the vulnerability and resilience of adolescents, identifying when and how digital experiences magnify certain vulnerabilities, like anxiety and depression, and when they support adolescent well-being and identity development. We'll consider the cultural dimensions of teens' social media experiences and how they put pressure on some teens while marginalizing others. We'll also discuss the ways teens are pushing back against these challenges by developing their own strategies for self-directed, community-supported digital experiences. Chapter 8 addresses our oldest youth, emerging adults, examining how they use networked technologies to connect their developing sense of self to social issues they care about. We'll explore how networked technologies have changed the way young people engage in public discussions about social issues, centering their voices in unparalleled ways. We'll consider when online forms of activism can be empowering for these youth, and when they can lead to feelings of psychological stress. I conclude each of these chapters in the same way, by taking stock with the three D's. I pull out key ideas relating to what is going on developmentally when children at a specific age and stage interact with various technologies. I then go deeper by highlighting the nuance and complexity that's underneath the top-level headlines, addressing both individual children and their social and cultural contexts. Finally, I consider the design considerations that can and should guide strategies for users, especially parents and children, to identify developmentally supportive technology experiences, and for technology developers to design at the outset with such experiences in mind. In the final chapter, Chapter 9, I present a model of developmentally supportive digital experiences that shows the major determinants of self-directed, community-supported digital experiences, and how these experiences can support children's healthy development. I consider how different stakeholders can make these positive experiences the rule rather than the exception for technology's child. I offer a set of concrete suggestions for technology designers, technology companies, policymakers, parents and caregivers, teachers and school administrators, and academics and researchers. Chapter 2. Early Childhood. Learning Self-Control in a Tech-Saturated World. Gaining control over one's emotions and behavior, also known as executive function, represents an important developmental undertaking during early childhood. This chapter examines the interplay between young children's developing executive function skills and their experiences with commonly used technologies, identifying those that can support executive function development and those that can undermine it. First, let's discuss how a child's executive function skills develop. Executive function can be thought of as the brain's air traffic control system. This constellation of skills manages the quantity and variety of information that comes at us during the course of a day, prioritizing and focusing on the important things, setting aside what is less important, though perhaps more enticing, making decisions, planning and revising plans, and moving back and forth between various goals and demands. Executive function dictates much of how we go about our day and how we engage with the world. Although executive function continues to develop throughout childhood and into adolescence, and even emerging adulthood, early childhood represents a sensitive period, a period when children are particularly responsive to environmental influences. Young children learn to regulate their actions and emotions, self-regulation, hold information in their heads for short periods of time, working memory, and switch gears and adjust their behavior according to situational changes, cognitive flexibility. These skills will influence how they act on, interact with, and react to the people and experiences they encounter through their lives. When things go well at this stage, children are positioned for future school readiness, both academically and socially, and they're better able to cope with stress and frustration. If things don't go so well, there's a greater chance they'll have trouble following directions, display disruptive or even aggressive behavior, and encounter interpersonal challenges with peers and teachers. For adults, executive function is central to most aspects of daily life, from performing well at work to maintaining healthy relationships. Anyone who's spent time with a toddler knows that these skills take time to develop. 2-year-olds are much better at disrupting plans than making them. Children develop their executive functions.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.